Welcome back, everybody. In this next chapter of our course, we're going to talk about measures of variability. Measures of variability are incredibly important in the field of statistics. In general, the way I see it, we wouldn't even need statistics if we didn't have variability. When there's variability in our data, it makes everything a little bit more complicated. It makes things more interesting, but it also makes things more complicated. Imagine a world with no variability. If I wanted to see if a new treatment for COVID-19 works, all I would need is two people sick with the disease. I'd give one person the new treatment, and I'd give the other person a placebo. And if I found a difference and that the person treated did better than the person receiving the placebo, then I'd know that the treatment works and that it would work on everybody. But in the real world, variability exists. Depending on what we're measuring, sometimes there's lots and lots and lots of variability. And as I mentioned before, that just makes things a little bit more complicated. So we need to know how to measure variability. And we're going to learn in this chapter how to measure variability in a couple different ways. We're going to talk about the range, the interquartile range, and also the standard deviation. You'll see that each of those measures pairs well with a measure of central tendency. And just like we did with the measures of central tendency, for each measure of variability, we'll talk about its strengths and its weaknesses. Measures of variability are also known as measures of dispersion. Think about it this way. I'm trying to determine how are the data points dispersed across the distribution. So in addition to knowing where the middle of the distribution is, I want to know how are the data points dispersed to the left and to the right. It's going to be really important that we find a good measure of variability because measures of central tendency only tell an incomplete story. Look at these two distributions. Imagine that we're graphing exam scores. And scores can range from very low, like a score of 0, to very high, like a score of 100. If we focus on measures of central tendency, in both of these situations, the mean, the median, and the mode will equal 60. But can't you see that these distributions tell different stories? Don't the scores vary in one distribution more than they do in another distribution? Look at this distribution right here. The scores are really pretty tight. Students scored, for the most part, somewhere between about 55 and 65. That's where most students score. But look at this distribution up here. Most of the students are scoring somewhere between 40 and 80. That's a much larger range, much more variability. And how would you answer this question? In which distribution, the top one or the bottom one, does a measure of central tendency better describe the entire distribution? In other words, in which distribution does a measure of central tendency best represent the distribution? Well, in this distribution, there's less variability, so the scores are more similar. So really, in this case, this measure of central tendency, 60, does a better job than this measure of central tendency, again, 60, of representing the entire distribution. And thus, I've just summarized two important points about measures of variability. A good measurement of variability is going to tell us how spread out the scores are. They're more spread out in this situation than they are in this situation. And also, a good measure of variability will tell us how well any particular measure, like a mean, represents the entire distribution. What I just said there is pretty much summarized in these next two pages of notes. I mentioned that a good measurement of variability is going to tell us how much distance we would expect to find between the scores. And I mentioned that a good measurement of variability is going to tell us how well any individual score, like the mean, represents an entire distribution. It's also important to understand that not all measures of variability are created equally. Just like when we talked about measures of central tendency, we didn't determine that they're all equal. Each one had its value. Each one had its own time and place. But all things being equal, we really like the mean because it had some properties that were unique. The same thing is going to be true of the three different measures of variability that we talk about. We'll talk about the range, the interquartile range, and the standard deviation. We're going to see that some of those measures are more simplistic than others. Some of those measures take into account more data than others. Some of those measures can be built upon more than others. These are some of the same issues that we talked about with central tendency, and that's good, because that part of the discussion should sound familiar. Let's jump into the kiddie pool first and talk about the most simplistic of the three measures of variability, the range. The range is really a great measure. It gives us important information and it's really easy to compute. All it tells us is the distance between the largest value and the smallest value in our data set. When we discuss the range, we're going to make a distinction between discrete data and continuous data. Let's talk about discrete data first. Remember, discrete data only makes sense in terms of whole values, whole categories. We only measure things in this case in terms of whole values or whole categories. Imagine if we had a patient in the hospital who was experiencing hallucinations. We might measure this person each day and keep track of how many episodes they experience of some type of major hallucination. You can see in this case, only whole numbers make sense. If the person experiences 2 hallucinations, that makes sense. 4 hallucinations, that makes sense. But to say 3.5, that doesn't really make sense. So we're clearly dealing with discrete data. So here's our data for our patient over 1 week. There's clearly variability in the data, and that's what we're trying to capture here with the range. We know that the range is simply the distance between the largest value and the smallest value. So we find the largest value, in this case 12 hallucinations that day. We find the smallest value, which is just 1, that was a pretty good day. And then we compute the range. We take 12, we subtract 1, and we find a range of 11. So the distance between the largest value and the smallest value is 11 hallucinations. That, my friends, is the range. It's very simple. It's very simple to understand. It's very simple to communicate. Those are going to be things that we like about the range. When we have continuous data, then we take into account real limits. So again, back on the psych ward, let's say we're looking at the patients who we have here today, and we're looking at the range of ages. Ages range today from a person who's 62 years old to a person who's 17 years old. Keep in mind, it's pretty unlikely that all these people were having birthdays today. So this person who's 17, when we think about it in terms of real limits, it's possible that person was as old as 17 and a half. And in our data set, we listed them as 17. It's possible that that person was as young as 16 and a half, and we listed that person as 17. And likewise, this person in our data set who's listed as 62 years old, that person might be as young as 61 and a half or as old as 62 and a half. Those are the real limits that encompass that value of 62. So we're going to take those real limits into account, and we're going to use them to maximize the potentiality of that range. And this is the way that we're going to do it. We're going to take the upper real limit of that largest x value, and then we'll subtract the lower real limit of that smallest x value. So in this case, the largest value was 62. Its upper real limit is 62 and a half. The lowest value was 17. Its lower real limit is 16 and a half. When we take 62.5 and we subtract 16.5, we find a range of 46 years. So the distance between the oldest person and the youngest person is potentially 46 full years. I always think it's smart to find ways to be able to check your work. And in this case, we should be able to find the exact same value computed a different way. Think about what we're doing here. We're taking that largest x value and we're adding a half a year to the range. We're also taking that smallest x value, 17, and do you see how we're adding another half year to the range? So when we compute the range for continuous data, incorporating real limits, the value that we get is essentially the same value that we would get if we were to just compute the range as we would normally with discrete data and then add 1. Let's test that to make sure. The oldest person was 62 years old. We're going to subtract the age of the youngest person who is 17 years old, and then we're going to add to that 1. And again, we get the value of 46. All right, my friends, we're at that point where we're going to talk about what we like and don't like so much about the range. In other words, we're going to evaluate it. A couple things that I really like about the range is that it's intuitive, it's quick, it's easy. You don't need to take a stat class to understand the range. You can talk about the range with anybody. It's easy to communicate. Those are all great things. Because the range is really so simple to understand, it's so straightforward, it pairs really well with the mode, which is a measure of central tendency that's very intuitive, very straightforward. Now that said, there are some drawbacks to the range. Think about how we compute the range. Of all the values in our data set, the range is really computed based on two values, the largest value and the smallest value. And if there are outliers in our data, where would we find them? We would find them at the extremes, the largest values or the smallest values. So what I'm trying to say is the range is incredibly influenced by outliers. If there are extreme scores in our data set, if there are outliers, the range might not do a good job of capturing how much variability really exists in the data. And as I was just mentioning, when we compute the range, it's really just based on two values, the largest score and the smallest score. So in general, it fails to evaluate all the scores. Remember, one thing we really liked about the mean was that when you computed it, it was based on every single score. Every single score had a say in the final answer. When we compute the range, the final answer is just based on two values from your data set, the largest value and the smallest value. So, of course, we're going to want to look at some other options. We're going to want to find some more sophisticated measure of variability. Because overall, the range is somewhat crude and somewhat unreliable. So my friends, in the next video, we're going to learn about the interquartile range. It improves upon the range in one aspect. It does not include the most extreme values in the data set. So when we do have outliers in our data, we're going to find that the interquartile range really does a pretty nice job. We'll talk about that next. In the meantime, be safe.